Good morning, online campus, and welcome to Beltway Park. We are so excited for this morning. My name is Sarah Turner. I'm the online campus pastor, and today I have with me my life group leader, y'all.
Morning. My name is Todd Mitchell.
And I'm excited to have you. You're also our drummer today.
I am.
So you're going to have
morning.
To scoot in a little bit. But before we do that, what are you excited and what are you looking forward to today, this morning?
I'll tell you, this morning we had a really, really worshipful rehearsal before church. And that's not something that always happens.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of times you're just focused on what needs to be done to prepare for the service. But this morning, we had a really worshipful time and an experience with the Lord this morning during worship. And so I think God has a lot in store this morning. So I'm really excited to see what he's going to do.
I agree. I think the Lord has some good things for his kiddos today. And that includes you guys, wherever you're watching from. So whether you're in the surrounding area and you're just unable to come to one of our physical campuses, or you were out of town or out of state, or you permanently live out of state, we want to know you're welcome here. You're welcome here. And if you've never connected with us in our community online, as far as like within the chats, we would love for you to drop a hello and let us know where you're watching from. But beyond that, we want to invite you to participate in something that's coming up soon, right? We love our city coming up. You've probably heard us talking about this a lot before. Mm-hmm. The basic premise behind We Love Our City is just blessing other people, right?
That's right.
And being a blessing to those that we see or that we live around. And so what are some ideas that come to your mind as far as like how it looks and what it looks like to be a blessing?
Well, just anything comes. I mean, I know that our life group sat in my front yard and cooked hot dogs for people walking around one time. So, I mean, it's something as simple as that.
Yeah.
Or you can go and you know, serve at a nonprofit or, you know, anything that comes to mind. I mean,
yeah.
It can be as much or as little as you want it to be.
That's right.
You just need to meet the needs of people around you.
That's right. And don't despise the small things, too. Sometimes we think that this gesture of being a blessing has to be this big thing, but it really doesn't have to be this big thing.
No, not at all.
It can be something very small, like deciding that you're... This just came to my brain, so maybe it's for one of you out there. If there's a Walmart near you and you see all the grocery carts out not in their little spots where they're supposed to be, you know, you could bless the workers at Walmart by just putting the carts back. That right there would truly bless the people at Walmart. And I just thought about that, but that's just one small way, right? But We Love Our City is an opportunity for you or your group to get together and to find a way to bless the people that you either encounter. Maybe it's a business or organization.
Uh-huh.
Maybe it's just your neighborhood, like what Todd mentioned. But there are so many creative ideas. I want to invite you to go to beltway.org/we love our city to find out like what are some of those questions that you can begin to be asking, because that's all going to start. Let's see. What's the date? I think it's next week. I think it's the 16th through the 23rd.
Okay.
But it's an opportunity for you, your family, your life group, who you do life with, to be able to love people that you're around. I think that's massive.
That's what we're called to do. And
that's right. Love God, love people.
One of the great things about being a part of God's church.
Yes, it is. And I love that we get to all do this together. So, I mean, here at the South Campus and at the North Campus as well, we've got the We Love Our City shirts, which is always a lot of fun.
They're in the foyer today here.
They're in the foyer today here. So if you're around the Abilene area and want to come grab one, and I know you need to get going so you can get to your drums. That was a fast 4 minutes, wasn't it? Okay, I'll see you back afterwards. But, okay. Whew, we got 20 seconds, so that went really fast. But what I want to do is encourage you guys, whatever you are, whatever you're doing, let's press into that place this morning of connecting and bringing our offering to the Lord. That's what his desire is. His desire is to meet with you today. His desire is to rest his presence with you. So we're so glad you're here. Let's join him and worship him together.
Good morning, Beltway Park. I'll praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure, praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when outnumbered, praise when surrounded. 'Cause praise is the water my enemies drown in. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise. I praise cause you're sovereign, praise cause you reign, praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I praise cause you're faithful, praise cause you're true, praise cause there's nobody greater than you. I praise cause you're sovereign, praise cause you reign, praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I praise cause you're faithful, praise cause you're true, praise cause there's nobody greater than you. Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
Way to start church this morning. We are so excited that you are here, whether you're in person or joining us online. We want to say welcome to Beltway Park. Before we keep going on this fantastic morning, we have some people who are ready to make a public declaration of their faith in Jesus. We've got some baptisms this morning.
All right, church family, this morning we have Adley May. She's 8 years old. She's going to be baptized by her sister Tinley. So, Adley, have you surrendered your life to Jesus Christ? Yes. And do you choose to follow him all the days of your life by the power of the Holy Spirit and with the grace of God? Yes. Okay. It's with that profession of faith, it's our honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. That's sweet. Okay, we have another family coming. This is Josiah Priest. He's 10. He's going to be baptized by his dad, Christopher. All right, Josiah, have you surrendered your life to Jesus Christ? Yes, all right. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, by the grace of God, do you commit to follow him all the days of your life? That's a yes. All right. Well, with that profession of faith, it's our honor to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Man, that's some good stuff right there. Well, we are going to continue on into worship, but before we do, man, we've had the opportunity already to give God praise this morning. And you know, God's word says that when we enter his presence, that we get to enter with thanksgiving and praise. So this morning is an opportunity to continue on in worship, to bless God's name. You know, I don't know what part of his name means the most to you right now. I can tell you right now that the fact that he's my provider and my shelter is what I'm claiming right now. What are you claiming right now about God's nature and character in your own life? Because God's good regardless of whether we are in a valley or on the mountain. God is good whether we are in a place of desperation or a place of plenty. God is good no matter where we find ourselves. And this morning, we get an opportunity to continue to lift his name high. And the song we're about to sing is based out of Psalm 34. And it all declares God's goodness. But I love Psalm 34:1. And it says it like this in the message. I love this. It says this: I bless God every chance I get. My lungs expand with his praise. Get that picture in just a moment of your lungs expanding as you praise God. Do you need the breath of God in your life this morning? If you do, I want to encourage you to press in this morning with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength, because God is good. Amen. Amen. Is God good? Let's allow our praise to come up and out. Lord, we bless your holy name. God, we thank you that your presence is in this place and that you are here with us. God, we bring you glory and honor as we worship you today. Father, we as your children love you. God, we as your children bless you. And we look forward to telling you more of why we're so grateful for you this morning. Let's worship him together today.
Yeah. of life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse is blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. But not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake, and the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens roared. Jesus.
God Almighty reigns.
Thank you.
You, for your name is holy and worthy to be praised. God, we are your people, and we praise you because of what you have done for us. But more than that, God, we praise you for who you are. God, you are the Savior of the world. You are Creator, God, who created us in your image. Lord, thank you for inhabiting the praises of your people today. God, we pray that you are glorified and honored through your children, through your sons, and through your daughters. God, we praise your holy name, and we will never, ever, ever tire of praising of your name, God. We bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, church, you can go ahead and have a seat. Again, good morning and welcome to Beltway Park. We are so pumped. I don't know if you can tell, but we're excited about today. There's going to be some good things in store for us today. God has good stuff for his kids, does he not? He's got good stuff for his kids. Well, all right, if you are a first-time guest with us, we especially want to welcome you. If you do us a favor, in the chair back in front of you, there's a guest card you can fill out. If you would take that guest card out to one of our guest services kiosks after the service today, we have a gift that we would love to give you and answer any questions that you might have. And online campus, hey guys, we have a guest card that's going to drop in the chat platform for you as well. Fill that out, and the next week you will receive a gift from me too. And then we want to go ahead and invite any of you who are like thinking about taking that next step, because you've probably heard it before, but we are a church family who exists to help each other take our next steps with Jesus. But sometimes we don't know what that next step might look like. So sometimes it can be, well, I think I might be ready for baptism. We saw some baptisms today of some kiddos. It was fantastic. But maybe your next step is to serve. Maybe your next step could be membership or jumping into an essentials class. We want to be able to help you identify that next step. So Start Here is the perfect place to go. It's right after this service. Out those doors, there's an awning and a sign. You can't miss it. It's just a few minutes. Your kiddos will be well taken care of in children's ministry. But what we want to do is just help you identify that next step. And then online campus, we have a Start Here online for you as well. Just go to beltway.org/start-here-online, and you can actually pick a time that works best for your schedule. And then you and I will meet one-on-one so that we can talk about your next step as well, because you are a part of our church family. All right, and then church family, if you have come today prepared to give your physical tithes and offerings, you can drop those off in the black boxes on your way out. But there's lots of ways you can give. You can give online, text in to give through the app.
Any way you give, we want to just say thank you. Thank you so much for investing in the mission and vision of Beltway Park. And then there's two things we want to keep in front of you today. And the first is about We Love Our City. I'm sure you've noticed the bright minty green We Love Our City t-shirts. They're so perfect for spring. But we have We Love Our City Week coming up March 16th through the 23rd. We have an opportunity to bless our neighbors. Bless the people that we see every day, whether it's an organization or a ministry that we want to partner with, or it's people in your very own neighborhood. What we want to do is invite you to go to beltway.org/we love our city, gather a group of people together, gather your life group, gather your girl group, gather your friends that you do golf with, whoever you might do life with, gather together, and let's go out and let's bless our city and show the love of God to people who are in need of it, all right? And the second thing we want to keep in front of you is about healing prayer. So every other week on a Tuesday night, there is a group of people who gather here at this campus at 7 p.m. to pray for people, to lay hands on people, regardless if they need healing in the physical, the mental, or the spiritual. We believe God is a healer. That is who he is and what he does. And he still heals today. So if you need healing, we want to invite you to Tuesday, March 19th at 7 p.m. right here at the South Campus. But if you cannot physically come in person to our healing, one of our healing prayer nights, online campus, we have a healing prayer online for you as well. I promise you, it is incredible to be able to join into a Zoom room with a group of people who want to pray for you, because God is not limited by a building. God is omnipresent. He is everywhere. And he is his love and his desire is to connect with us regardless of where we are. So online campus, all you need to do is go to beltway.org/healing, and you can reserve a spot to meet with us online, and we will send you a Zoom invitation. All right, let's bow our heads and prepare our hearts for the message today. God, we thank you that your word has been prepared for us. God, we want to taste and see that you're good. We want to hear your word, but not just be hearers of your word. God, our desire is to be doers of your word. May your word penetrate our hearts, and may we leave here different than we came. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning. Hey, welcome. My name is Jeffrey. I am one of the pastors on the team, and I am honored to get to jump into our Guardrails series this morning. If you are relatively new around one of our campuses, I want you to know how honored I am that you're here. I know that this is Time Change Sunday, and you are all first service people. That is so that means one of two things. One, your body clock just didn't agree with you, or two, you have young kids, because they do not care about time change at all, and they won't for the next week, and then all of a sudden they're going to be back on schedule. So there is hope coming for you. So I'm excited about this morning and the word I feel like the Lord laid on my heart. There's a phrase that's been around since the 1700s. It was made popular by Ben Franklin, and the phrase is time is money. And that thought, time is money, is basically talking about how when we waste time, we waste money. And so today we're going to talk about that. How does that sound? So I need a volunteer. So I have one of my best friends in the world, Jordan Ziemer. I need you to come up here. That was your cue, buddy. So on Thursday when I did this, I'll throw Mason under the bus because he's in a mission trip in New Orleans. On Thursday when I did this, Mason left the room, forgot he was supposed to be here, and was gone completely. So Jordan, you can stand over here. This is Jordan Ziemer. He's one of my best friends, even if he did go to A&M. So, I mean, you didn't have to do that. That was unnecessary. At least you didn't whoop, and that could have completely ruined my sermon. So Jordan helps he works in our school system, and so we're going to test his math ability this morning, okay? You didn't get your doctorate in maths? Okay, so there you go. That is 79 $1 bills. You don't have to count those. I could have messed them up. I got my degree in sociology, so that was excellent. But 79 can feel like a relatively random amount of money. It is the amount of years that most people live. So the median age for people to live right now is 79 years. And it feels like when you think of that number, and it feels pretty good. I mean, it's not an insignificant amount of cash. It's 79 $1 bills. Here's the problem. We spend that so much faster than we think. For example, did you know that we spend 26 years of our life sleeping? So go ahead and count out 26 and then set them on this pretty table right behind you. 26 years of our life sleeping, and everyone that has newborns does not believe that at all, but we really do. 26 years of our life sleeping. Now, the number that's a little more believable is we spend 7 years of our life trying to fall asleep. So you can count out 7 more $1 bills. That number feels real, right? 7 years feels like a real number that we spend trying to fall asleep. We spend, on average, we will spend just about 13 years of our life working. We'll spend 1.3 years, so you can just put 1 for that. We'll spend 1.3 years of our life at the gym. Some of you, that number feels real. Others of us, it does not. We'll spend 4 years of our life eating. That definitely feels real. You can count off another 4. Every time, yeah, that's, you're catching on. Good job, buddy. We'll spend 8.3 years of our life. You can't break that up, so just count 8. 8.3 years of our life watching TV and movies. We'll spend 3 years of our life on social media. If you go from kindergarten to get your undergraduate degree, you will spend 2.75 years of your life in school. 3, you can put 3 down. Thanks, buddy. 3 years. Now, it can be a little alarming that we spend almost 3 years of our life going to school if you go all the way to get your undergraduate degree, and we definitely spend 3 years of our life on social media, but that's a different sermon for a different day. And what we're left with after this should be roughly $14. If I didn't miss anything. How many was it? It was 14? Yeah, man. Sociology for the win. That sociology joke got way more laughs than it was supposed to. Listen, it was useful. We start out with $79, 79 years. And without choosing anything, we're left with 14. All right, y'all give Jordan a hand. Thank you, Jordan. Shake my hand. We started out with 79 years that we got to spend, and it feels like a lot. It feels like it might be a significant amount until all of a sudden we start spending 26 years here and 13 years over here and then 4 years in this area. And we look up, and without even doing anything that we wanted, without doing any kids' things or hobbies or church, without choosing anything at all, we're left with this amount. We went from a stack of cash to this is all we have left to choose from. And this week, as I was thinking about our life and about the sermon and about where we're going to go today and about guardrails, I thought, this feels so weighty now. I started out with what felt like a lot and a lot of things I could choose from and a lot of ways I could spend my life, and yet here we are. This is all I get. And if that's the case, if this is the amount of years that we get in our life, then we should learn to spend it well. Here's the problem. We have an enemy, and he's very, very crafty. And he would love nothing more than for us to waste the little amount of years that we get to choose how we spend. One of the primary ways that he does that is by getting us to live our lives distracted. Because if he can get us to take one of our years even and just toss it aside. Or maybe we live really distracted, and that 14, which is now 13, now becomes just 12. And if he can get us to just waste a little bit here and a little bit there, then we're missing out so much on what we could have and the life we could live. It is easy to be distracted. Social media shows us that, right? I don't know about you. It's easy to come home at the end of a day and sit on my couch and go, I'm just going to turn my brain off for a minute. So you look on Instagram for just a few minutes. You catch all the way up. So then you open up Facebook because you really want to see what your acquaintance from 14 years ago thinks about the current political climate. Then you get off that as fast as humanly possible. But it's almost dinner time, and so you gotta find something to eat for dinner. So you look up Pinterest, and you're just scrolling through trying to find a good recipe. And then after you've pinned enough DIY projects to last 3 lifetimes, you jump onto TikTok. And without thinking about it, we've been so distracted that we've wasted an hour and a half of our evening just mindlessly doom scrolling through social media. Here's how bad it is. Here's how easy we are to be distracted. TikTok, on its own app, runs an ad that tells you you've been scrolling too long, get off TikTok. Think about that Their whole goal is to make money and get people to scroll through their videos. And yet even they recognize that it can be such a problem that they tell you to get off their own app. It's so easy to live life distracted. It's one of the cleverest tactics that the enemy uses, because it's not that he has us choose bad things. It's not that he entices us to choose bad things. He often just lets us settle for good. Distractions usually lead us to choosing what is good but not best in our life. And if the enemy can get us to choose good and not best, then we'll waste the little amount of years that we have to choose from. If he can get us to settle for good, not best. One of the areas that we see this example, probably most prevalent in my mind, is in marriages. It's easy in a marriage to settle for good and not best. The marriage usually begins with two people dating, right? And when you're dating, that person is your world. You love them, you wanna be with them. I mean, they're the second most important thing to you that's not Jesus. So you wanna spend every second with them. You're eating, you wanna be with them. You're studying, you study better when they're there, which is not true. You want coffee, they should be there. You need to breathe, you all have to breathe. Let's breathe together. And then things keep going well. You get engaged. You begin to plan your life together. The house and the car and the minivan. The yard and the little puppy, the doodle. Then after that, you stand in front of your friends and family and you declare that forever and always they will be your number two. For richer or poorer, in sickness and in health, as long as you both live, that is your person. Then you begin to live life. The job starts to be a lot. And then you have kids. And listen, I love my kids, but they're world changers in the good and the bad. You sleep different. Then your kids get older. And they start to have activities. And then their activities have activities. And somehow the activities just multiply at an exponential rate. You got a hobby car in the garage. And it's so easy to look up 5, 10, 15 years into your marriage and go, when was the last time we talked about us? When was the last time I asked my wife, hey, how's your heart? What's the last date night we went on? And this is supposed to be your person. This was the one you said you were, everything didn't matter except for them. It was God and then them and then everything else fell under that. And without meaning to, we chose good things, but not always the best things. And listen, jobs are good. Some would even say necessary. Kids, amazing. Hobbies, they're important for our mental health. These are things that matter. They're good things. They just aren't always best. And a distraction-filled life lures us into good and not best. And I don't know about you, but I want best. If what God offers is best, if it's abundant, if it's life and life in abundance, if that's what God offers, then that's what I want. I want what is best. I want a life of significance. I want to matter. I want these years that I have, I don't want to waste one of them, much less all 14. I don't want to waste a second. If this is all I get, I want what is best. And so scripture tells us this in Lamentations, let us test and examine our ways and return to the Lord. The invitation of scripture is to look at our lives and see how are we spending our life. We do not have enough to waste. If you leave with anything and it is this image of this little amount of money, just don't waste a second of it. Don't waste one single dollar. And Lamentations says, test and examine your ways. And we see that talked about in the book of Ephesians. So if you will, if you'll grab a Bible, we're going to be Ephesians chapter 5. If you didn't bring a Bible, there's one around you. If you're at our online campus, we love that you're there. There's a Bible right there on the screen. Ephesians 5 verse 15 says this, look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. I love that Paul begins this by saying, look carefully. Those are two words that combined mean something even greater. Look, but don't just look. Look carefully how you walk. I read these words this week and immediately got convicted because I can't necessarily tell you that I do a good job looking carefully. I can tell you from like my job perspective all that I did last week. I can tell you down to the minute how many hours I spent in meetings or prepping a sermon or in my own personal professional development. I can tell you how I spent in each of those areas, but in my life, I think we had dinner twice together last week as a family. I know that we did some fun stuff. I know that laundry moved from the dryer to the couch. Those things all happened. But I can't tell you that I did a great job of looking carefully. And what Paul is telling us is examining our lives is vitally important if we want to spend our lives on what is best. What Lamentation says and what Paul says in Ephesians 5 is, hey, we have to look, but don't just look. Look carefully at your life. Examine how you are living your life if you want to settle, if you want to go after best and not settle for good. So where are you at? Would you say that you can look carefully, or you get in the habit of looking carefully at your life? Because when we make it a habit to look carefully at our lives, what we do is we minimize distractions, and minimizing distractions protects us from us and acts as a guardrail to keep us on the road we're supposed to be on. Listen, you and I both need to be protected from us. Without a guardrail, I promise you this, I can fill up my life with the best of them. I can find an activity over here and a hobby over here and another project at work over here. I can fill up my life as good as anyone can. And if we don't get in the habit of minimizing what is pulling us away from the main thing, we'll settle for good and not best. But Paul goes on. He says, look carefully then. And then is a huge word in here. Because what Paul is hearkening back to, he's calling back to something that he said just a few verses before, and he's saying this, hey, you have the ability to look carefully at your life. You have it inside of you. For at one time you were in darkness, but now you are light in the world. Walk as children of light. Before Jesus, where everyone is at is in darkness. We were all there at one point in time. And before we found Jesus, we live our life in the dark. And listen, it is impossible to examine your life in the dark. You want to know why? Because it's dark and we can't see. We recognize darkness in the physical sense. You're asleep in your bed and you hear your kid cry from the other room. You get up and you feel the darkness because you're walking in the minefield that is your house. You're trying not to step on the dog. You don't want to hit the nightstand, trying to get the door handle and not put your head through the door. You find the one Lego that's still on the ground and you step on it. We understand physical darkness, but listen, if we don't walk as children of the light, we can never look carefully at our lives. It is impossible for me to examine my life if I stay stuck in darkness. There is hope in the light. There's hope in what it looks like to live as a children of the light. I don't want to settle for darkness when light is offered. And what Jesus said is this, I am the light of the world. Whoever, say whoever, whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will live, will have the light of life. Look carefully then. You who can walk in the light, look carefully then so that we live not as unwise but as wise, making the best use of our time because the days are evil. Do the days feel evil? Yeah. I'm not. If you answer no to that, you do a much better job at hiding from the news. Yeah, the days feel evil. The world feels pretty dark. And Paul says, hey, make the best use of your time. Live as wise, not as unwise. Use every moment that you have in the best way possible. Don't waste one single year. Don't waste one single moment. Make the best use of your time. And for the vast majority of us, the reason we settle for a good life and not the best life is because good distracts us away from best. And if I'm just raw honest with you today, I'm tired of good. I love my life. I do. I have an amazing wife. We've been together many years. This is math on the fly. 21. This summer, we'll have been married 18 years. I have two incredible daughters because they're like their mom. I love what I get to do here. It's an honor to get to preach and lead here. I've been on staff 17 years. I have incredible friends. And very often, I can catch myself settling for good. This week, as I thought about this passage, I began to look carefully at my life. I could give you more than one example of a way in my life I've settled for good and not best because I was too lazy to look carefully at my life, and so I just got distracted and I filled my life up with stuff. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of our time. And the way that we do that is by taking the words of Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount. And he said, why do you worry about clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? So do not worry, what shall we eat or what shall we drink or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. And I love when Jesus says these words in the Sermon on the Mount, he doesn't say, hey, those things are insignificant. Clothes matter. I'm thankful for them in this moment as I look out at all of you. Food, drink, without it, we die. Jesus doesn't say, hey, those things are insignificant. They don't matter at all. Who cares? Why are you even thinking about those things? Those things, just forget them. You don't need them. No, he doesn't say that. He just says, why are you worried about them? Why is that your focus? If we put it in our modern context, why do we worry so much about our jobs? Why do we worry so much about our kids getting on that second or third travel team? Why do we worry so much about fitting in with that friend group? Jobs, they matter. Friend groups matter. Relationships, they matter. Your kids, they matter. Jesus doesn't say, hey, those things are, forget them. They are completely and wholly insignificant. He just says, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. But then all those things will be given to you as well. When we go after the best found in Jesus, the good follows it. When we let distractions pull us away from best, we settle for good. When we go after the best that's found in Jesus and in seeking him first, when that is our goal, our focus, when we go after what is best in him, then we'll never settle for good because we're seeking first his righteousness. But then the promise of Matthew 6 and Jesus' words is that all those things will be given to you as well. If we're making the best use of our time, it's because we are seeking Jesus first and trusting him with everything else. This, way easier to say than do. I've stood on this stage and told you that I can often wrestle with the anxiety of what do we eat, what do we drink, or what do we wear. Not necessarily those things. I don't generally care that much about what I wear. I do care about what I eat. But like the other things of life, I can go from perfectly fine to full of anxiety in a hurry. And Jesus is saying, hey, just seek me first and trust me with all the rest. So if we're going to take what we've been given and we're going to seek him first and trust him with everything else so that I don't waste one moment of my life. If we're going to do that, how do we practically do it? We're going to get super practical. We could go with all the cliches like put the big rocks in first, make the main thing the main thing. Those are all cliches because they're all true. We have to make the most important things the most important things if we're going to seek him first. And if we eliminate distractions and seek him first by being at church regularly. Obviously, I love what the Lord is doing here. I've been on staff 17 years. I've done just about every role except kids ministry. I love what God is doing at our church. But this is not about Bellway. Something you don't know. Every Sunday morning, whether I'm here or at the North Campus, I walk around the worship center, and I just am praying over you, what God's going to do that morning. If David's preaching, I'm praying over him. But then I text Blake White, who leads Southside Baptist Church in town. Blake, man, I'm so proud of you. I'm excited about what God's going to do in Southside this morning. Preach with authority, brother. I text Wes Terry, who leads Broadview. And God's doing cool stuff over there. Wes, dude, I'm excited about what God's going to do this morning. Can't wait to hear about it. I text John Witten, who leads Pioneer Drive Baptist Church. He's a friend of mine since college. John, homie, just be you this morning. You are his son doing what you're called to do. I text Austin Lawrence and J.R. Cochran, who lead The Well. Guys, I love hearing what God's doing at The Well. Lead well this morning. Enjoy his presence. Because this is not about Bellway. And I love Bellway. Wholeheartedly. I love that you're here. But we've said for years at this place, how many churches are there in Abilene?
One.
And we want to chase after Jesus together. There's something that happens when we get together. And even when you can't be at a physical campus, we've got an incredible online campus that people jump into every week, hundreds of people. When we worship together, when we take some time out of our week to focus on him and on what he has for us, when we take our kids to kids ministry and they're over there getting to learn all about God and the stats, every stat you see tells you that the vast majority of people that follow Jesus follow him before they're 18, and our kids are over there learning about him right now. When we can make him first, and we eliminate distractions, when we will get together corporately and worship. We also eliminate distractions and seek him first by being in community. We are people that are made to do life together. We need the community around us. I'm going to leave this on the screen while I tell you about my community. My life group leader's name is Todd. He's been my life group leader for 12 years. Jordan, the guy who derailed my opening thing, he's in our life group. I got a guy named Noel in my life group, Scott in my life group, and all their wives as well. Those guys, they can call me into account as soon as they see my life out of whack. And they do. Being in community helps us stay on the path we're supposed to be on and not get pulled away by every shiny thing that's in front of us and by whatever might be distracting us. We eliminate distractions and seek him first by reading the Bible. I hesitated even to put this on here because it feels like every week when David or I preach, we tell you, hey, you need to read the Bible. And then I was like, no. You know why we say it every week? Because it is God's holy word. It is the way that he is revealing himself to us. You want to know God? Read his Bible. You want to hear God? Read his Bible. You want to know about his heart for you? Read his Bible. You want to know his heart for the world? Read the Bible. You want to know what he thinks about sin and grace and hope and peace and freedom? You want to know anything about God? It can be found in his scripture. It is the way he is revealing himself to the word, to the world. One of the primary ways is through his word. Yeah, if we want to eliminate distractions and seek him first, it's going to happen through his word. I can almost guarantee you it will not happen without it. It's that important. Just like this one. We eliminate distractions, seek him first by praying. Prayer changes us. If we pray like Jesus said to pray, your kingdom come, your will be done, it changes me. But I was thinking about prayer this week. Did you know, before Jesus went to the cross, that not everyone just got to be in his presence and talk to God. There was the select few in the Old Testament and then the high priest. That's who got to talk to God, not everyone else. You and I get to speak to the one who created everything. The one who breathed the universe into existence listens to us. I think about that. Me, I'm a buffoon. He listens to me. In my good times when I'm just praising him, he listens to me. In the hard times, he's listening to me. When I need him desperately to move, he's listening to me. And here's the crazy part. He talks back. Prayer, getting to be in his presence and speak to him, is one of the greatest privileges that the life of a believer has. And yeah, it'll help us eliminate distractions a lot when we talk to him. We eliminate distractions, seek him first by serving his people. We talked about this a lot over the last series, how we're more blessed when we give than when we receive. And when we serve, we're giving of ourselves. Here's the hard part. Sometimes that's going to require you to say no to some things. It's going to require you to say no to being first at Chili's. Because you go to a service and then you serve in a service. Often it's going to require you to miss the first half of the Cowboys game. You should be thankful. What a blessing. I'm a Cowboys fan. We're just wounded. It might mean on a Wednesday night, where you normally have your routine of just being home on Wednesdays and doing your thing, that you come up here and you hang out with a middle schooler. You just love on them. Might mean that on a Saturday morning you get up early and you go at Beltway Garage. You help fix cars. But all that's going to require us to say no to some things so that we can say yes. And if we want to get real toe-steppy this morning, we've gotten pretty good at saying yes to good and pretty bad at saying yes to best. Saying no is hard, and yet it's vitally important if we want to eliminate the things that are distracting us. Those things are just a few. There are other things, like fasting. You want to eliminate distractions? Fast. Try it sometime. It doesn't have to be food. It may be social media. The best fast I ever did was on caffeine, because I adore caffeine. I love coffee, that first sip of coffee in the morning. The Sonic Diet Coke, it just hits different. I mean, it's beautiful. I love caffeine. And Sarah and I last year were really needing to hear the Lord on some stuff. And so we both fasted. I can't even remember what she fasted, but I fasted caffeine. So every day, the four times a day that I would normally either get coffee or a Diet Coke, and I wouldn't do it, it would remind me, oh, I need to talk to God about this. God, I need you to move. I need to hear your voice. I need to know your will. Fasting is just us saying no to something so that we can say yes to whatever he has for us. Communion can be the same way. It can help us eliminate distractions because we're just remembering that Jesus died on the cross for me, for my sins, so that I didn't have to. We have lots of ways, tools, that we can eliminate distractions and seek him first. The premise is not hard. The action is hard. But the promise of Jesus' words and the promise of Paul's words in Ephesians is that if we figure out how to look carefully at our lives and we seek him first and we eliminate the things that are distracting us, what we find on the other side of that is life and freedom and hope and peace. We find all those things as we seek him first. That's what Jesus said. Don't worry about all the other stuff. All you got to do is seek me, and then all the other stuff comes with me. Don't worry about what you eat or drink or what you wear. Just seek me first. And on the other end of seeking him first, what we find is that this time that we have, we don't waste. And it is so valuable. And there is so much less than we thought. So we should make the best use of our time. So the question I wanted to leave us with this morning is just this. How am I spending my life? That's your last blank. You can put your notes away. We're going to take just a moment and just listen for the Lord. At the end of the day, what I say up here does not matter. It's just what he says to you. How are you spending your life? Will we take just a moment and do what Paul said and look carefully how we're walking? Making the best use of our time. So you can bow your heads. Just for a moment, ask the Lord that. God, how am I spending my life? And then, would you be bold enough to say yes to whatever best is in Jesus by saying no to some things that are just good? God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you, God, for your presence. We thank you, God, that we can have best in you. Would we not settle for anything less than what you offer? God, if there are areas of our life where we've settled, God, would you show them to us? Like you did this week for me. Show us, God. Areas where maybe we've let distractions fill up our lives. And then would we be bold enough to say no to the things we need to say no to and say yes to the things you call us to? It's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. South Campus, if you will, if you'll stand up. Prayer team, you can come down. We have a few things the Lord laid on our heart this morning to pray over. And by few, I mean a whole sheet of paper worth. Someone who feels very scattered, their mind is all over the place. An old sprained ankle injury that's never healed correctly. Someone with a red beard. So you know who you are, and so does everyone around you. Someone with a strained relationship with their mother-in-law that they have been praying restoration and healing over. Someone knows they need to make a drastic step in obedience to the Lord but are stuck in fear. We got the picture of a wedding band with a missing stone. Someone feels like they lost a whole lot more this week than an hour of time. There's a remodel project going on in your home. Genuine fear or dread towards someone in your circle of life and it's shutting you down. Someone feels like they're stuck in negative thoughts, and a person who loves to water ski but hasn't been able to in years. Any of those things, anything else, we'd love the chance to pray for you. If you're comfortable with it, if you'll put your hands out in front of you and receive a prayer of blessing that's been prayed over God's people for a long time, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. Would he turn his countenance towards you and give you the peace that only he can give? Amen. Y'all have a great week.
Hey, online campus, thank you guys so much for joining us this morning. Wow, it was a good message about distractions.
Yes.
Man, I can get easily distracted.
I don't know about absolutely. You. Oh, absolutely. I'm all over the place.
Me too. It's a good, and the analogy this morning was good too, like just how are we spending our life, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I looked up one day and thought, holy cow, I have a almost 13-year-old, you guys, and I have 5 years left with her in my household before she... you know, moves on to
the
next season of her life.
I know, it's crazy how fast it goes. My oldest is 16, and I think she's a junior, and it's almost over. It's crazy how fast it goes.
Yeah. I mean, we get this one life to live, right?
That's right.
One life, and we are humans. We don't know how many sunrises we have left or evenings we have, and so, man, to make the most of the time. I think there's a verse in the scripture where it talks about making the most of our time. Mm-hmm. And that's, we don't have to, we can rest knowing that we don't have to figure that out alone, that we can do that in partnership with Holy Spirit and just staying in step with Him. Right?
Yeah. I mean, you know, the world would tell us things like carpe diem and seize the day and live life to the fullest. But I love that what the unique thing about what God says about that is that Jesus comes to bring to give life and to give it to the full. And so it's only through Him that we really experience the fullness of life.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know what I love, too, is that He's a redeemer. So He redeems time. He redeems rest.
Mm-hmm.
He redeems our resources. He redeems anything that will allow, like anything that we'll give to Him, right? And Lord, just would You take my life and use it for Your glory? Redeem my life for Your glory. Redeem my time. Help me to use my time for You and Your glory. It's just so such a good reminder this morning.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we're not going anywhere just quite yet. We have prayer partners ready and available to pray with you about anything going on in your world. It could be one of the prayer words that Jeffrey mentioned, or it could be something totally different. All you need to do is click the button to request prayer or text the word prayer to the number on your screen, and we would love to pray with you and partner with you in what God desires to do in your life. All right, you guys, that's it. That's all we have for today. We hope you guys have a phenomenal week. Be blessed. Happy spring break for those of you who are on one.
Yes.
And we'll see you back.
I get one because my kids have one.
Hey, that's awesome. We'll see you here back next week. Bye, guys.
Have a good week.